So I'm in a crowd of people who do extraordinary jobs in extraordinary settings. How many of you have done surgical airways? Not surprised. For me, are we moving on here? It's on me. Got it. Thank you. I came up with this head-mounted camera 25-plus years ago, trying to image laryngoscopy. I was scared to death of airway management, and I was especially scared to death of surgical airways, because the narrative in my head was, I have a very sharp instrument over somebody's neck, and I am not a surgeon. And there's a lot of soft, squishy things there that could bleed. And in fact, I was defeating myself. And this morning, Peter gave this wonderful lecture talking about human factors and saying how 95% of performance is not what you know, it's what you can do. And I have come to believe that for me, the mindset of how I approach my job has completely changed. And what I realize is nobody cares what I know. In the environments I work in, a single doc, two nurses, a dying patient, the family in the room, nobody cares that I lecture, that I've written, that I've published. Their loved one is dying in front of them, and I'm it. And that game, you know, every moment that we are speaking, as our prior speaker was addressing during his lecture, but every moment we are performing, it is a balance between perceived ability and perceived demand. And if that perception of demand exceeds your perception of ability, you freak out and performance goes to heck. I go every year to the Tetons for this wonderful course, and this is the view out the hotel. It's rather striking. There's a QR code here for a book. Feel free to download. At the age of 58, I decided to join the US military. I am still in the Navy. This has nothing to do with the military. I am a very conflicted person. I have many devices that I've been involved with in the development of, and I'm going to show you some of the, well, I'll show you the surgical models, but yeah. And I wanted just to thank Intersurgical for getting me here, but I do receive royalties on a few of these things. I am fascinated now with simplicity. The world is moving towards complexity. In America, we seem to wage airway management the way we wage war, with complexity and devices. So, you know, I have friends who think we should be doing VL and endoscopy on every airway. And I am gravitating more and more towards sorting simplicity. But not simplicity by itself, simplicity on the far side of complexity. And that great movie, Chernobyl, every lie begets a debt to the truth that sooner or later must be paid. Every complexity we put into our practice is a debt to crisis performance. So I'm going to share with you how I rethought my perception of crike. First off, I am not a surgeon. And I have an essential tremor jacked up by three cans of Monster and 24-hour shifts. And when I'm holding an instrument in front of a patient, and the husband is at the foot of the bed watching while I'm doing that surgical airway. And we asked him, are you staying? He goes, I'm not leaving. And I'll show you this case later. But my hand is in, you know, it's towards the side. My hand is resting on the sternum. So I am not a surgeon, but I can stabilize my hand on the sternum. I control how I think. I give myself permission to cut. These face-blasted people, they have surgically inevitable airways. When I just got a call this month, heads up, young adult, found down at home, we think was choking, and I knew this was headed towards a surgical airway. We came back into the room, the ambulance hadn't quite arrived, and I turned to the nurses and I said, I am not going out to that waiting room and telling that mother that their kid died without us doing everything. So I'm gonna spray the neck, we're gonna cut. And I envisioned what that would be like to tell mom that I didn't try. And after this young woman died, and I told this woman, I'm sorry, you know, we did everything we could. We opened up her neck. I wasn't going to, you know, declare her dead without trying everything. She stood up and she gave me a hug and she thanked me for it. but I prepare myself in my head for each of these issues. The anatomic insight, this is a matter of faith. When we start this procedure, I don't know where the cricothyroid membrane is. I have an idea, but I don't have to know. I will find it after the vertical skin incision, and the cartilaginous cage will protect, and I will show you what I mean by that. But we don't cut people who are hypoxic. We cut people who are dynamically deteriorating with altered anatomy, fluids with hypoxia, what I call the surgically inevitable, battlefield situations. But we have, as Michael mentioned, many ways now to oxygenate. So self-inflicted gunshot, about 20,000 a year in the United States. If you do emergency medicine in the States, you see a lot of gun violence. We ended up actually just pushing drugs on this person. The mandible, everything was unstable. We actually came from above in this case. But cutting the neck directly in these face-blasted situations, nobody would question. Stab wound to the face, tongue blows up like a rock instantly on the first laryngoscopy. This extraordinary physician who I worked with, he just picked up a knife, made that vertical skin incision, put the tube in, drops in the tube, stabilizes it, and turns to the nurse and says, "Will you tell trauma we're in CAT scan?" Now, most emergency docs would have picked up the laryngoscope and tried again. Most emergency docs would have said, "Call for help." People would have tried and failed. But this guy, he came out of the womb built to be an emergency physician. He travels to work with a bulletproof vest, I kid you not, a full Glock with extra mags, a backpack with an easy IO, 25 drugs in it. The man who is who you want when the three-year-old next-door neighbor falls out at three stories. Ed had this kid intubated, chest decompressed, easy IOs, fluids, like by the time the helicopter landed in the cul-de-sac. That's Ed. Now, I am not that guy. But Ed was just like on it. Like, this isn't going to end well. I'm picking up a knife. It's a one-inch freaking incision. Get over it. Anyway, here is epiglottitis, self-inflicted blast injury. Let's take a look at an epiglottitis case. People come from above, and we have made the surgical airway to be this thing that, like, we have to try from above, or we have to keep going, or if we see a little of this, then maybe we can get it. But this is a 19-year-old who, over the course of 12 to 16 hours, developed sore throat. So we had uvula, tonsil, and there's the epiglottis. Now, our instruments, modern airway management, is all indirect elevators of the epiglottis. And the only way you're going to be able to intubate that is to take your Big Mac 4 and go right under that epiglottis, or take a big straight blade and put it right into the laryngeal inlet. But they keep going, and video tends to do that to you. But it's interesting, there's a big pause, and I don't have time to show you, but when the video restarts, the nose is bloody, because they thought maybe go through the nose. But this was just panic and fear. But anyway, these cases, well, that's interesting. These cases, there are cases where we should just move, expressly to cutting the neck. And it's interesting that we engineer this procedure and we say, what's the first step of a crike? Well, find the cricothyroid membrane. So your heart rate above 115 is doing this. And with 1 centimeter, you're looking down at a person who has a chin here and neck that goes out like that, and they're built like this. And in your head, you say, I'm done. Like, I don't know where the CTM is. The first step has to be achievable and believable. And I look back on my understanding of this procedure, and the reason why I was so uncomfortable with it was I didn't know the anatomy. I don't think we confront fear. I think we unload it. You unload it through insight. The insight of the surgical airway is that the thyroid, superior cornu down to inferior cornu, the thyroid spans from hyoid to cricoid. The high back wall of the cricoid will keep you from injuring the patient with your knife going right in. And this thyroid-cricoid overlap, amazing. So this creates what I call the cartilaginous cage. But when you understand the anatomy, this doesn't intimidate you. look at every CAT scan that you order. I came up with laryngeal handshake because honestly, I didn't want to sit there with my fingers doing this to be defeated at the outset of every surgical airway. So what I tell myself is I do not need to find the CTM. I will find the CTM after the vertical skin incision, and I rock the rhomboid, AKA the laryngeal handshake, first. So, hi, how are you? Nice to meet you. I switch to my non-dominant hand to stabilize. The scalpel is driven into the sternum. The more nervous I am, the more my hand is down, my elbow is in. I'm never out in space, and I cannot do this with my left. I don't have to work in a helicopter. Some of you who do may need to get left-sided access, but that is not my thing. I am moving to the right side because I can do better there. So this model, which was made by Louis Thomas Jefferson Azu in 1835, here's our like bumper guards. We've got the thyroid cricoid overlap, the small ring anteriorly, the high back wall, the inferior superior cornu, and on CAT scan, every CT you look at, learn the cartilages. Appreciate the high back wall of the cricoid. Appreciate this male Adam's apple. And here's that thyroid cricoid overlap right there. So for me, this procedure was about demystification so that I was no longer fearful. This is a picture of me demonstrating laryngeal handshake on my ex-wife. I didn't cut her neck. We are friends. She was the right person to marry. We have two beautiful children, and I love her dearly. But it's interesting, you know, by the way, that there are no surgical models in the world made for the majority of humans, i.e. women. It's an interesting thought. But all right, laryngeal handshake. So I was at the conference yesterday, the ATAC, and a bunch of Danes came through, Soren and his colleagues, and they were doing this really simple thing, ripping the oxygen tubing and then the IV tubing and securing the tracheal tube. And I thought this was just freaking brilliant. So I've decided to call this the Danish necktie. And it kind of looks like a Danish, you know, flag. And yeah, but it works brilliant. You just take pieces of the plastic tubing, put in a clove hitch, and tie it around. I was like, wow. All right, so we're gonna be practicing this upstairs, but I find going down low, getting the water bottle softness, coming back up, then you bring in the knife, push your hand into the sternum, vertical skin incision. I go through the top layer first. I always go vertical, and I always verify the CTM. I never do a straight horizontal incision. And after you cut that top layer, and this uses a three-layer skin analog, after you cut that top layer, it's slimy, but you can feel the divot of the cricothyroid membrane. I rotate to horizontal, plunk over to the cricothyroid overlap, back the other direction, knife out, finger in. I don't move my hand until I know this is big enough that my fingertip fits. So it's always scalpel, finger, tube, and we can discuss the bougie. But if we could bring up the audio, I just want to share with you some of the world's greatest surgical airways. This is training. So they take this disarticulated specimen, they show it with a jackknife, and then they demonstrate where the CTM is, and they spin it around. If we could bring up the audio anymore on the volume, is it possible? So no gloves, 1950s, and the world's greatest crack video, you can catch it on my website, but they take all kinds of instruments just demonstrating to people how this is done. They pinch the skin. In this case, they take a pair of scissors, and they go, you'll have to pinch up the skin in order to grab it. And they then, you know, verify the location there, and then they take the scissors, and they go, chunk, and there's a line in here where it says, it's important to open the scissors and let the patient get some air. And it's just like, yeah, that's important. Anyway, so yeah, they open up the scissors and they let the patient get some air. And then they say, you know, place in a tube to keep the airway open. But so they demonstrate this tube going in. And then the next one, so they keep doing this with a variety of instruments. there is an acronym, N-A-V-Y, Navy, never again volunteer yourself. So let's try this with a razor blade. And, you know, all bleeding stops, and it's the 1950s, gloves don't exist. So, yeah, so they cut into the airway with the razor blade, cut through the membrane, insert a key or two to keep the airway open. It's just so good. And then they keep going. Like, I was like, all right, how are you going to top that? And I was like, huh. And they go, so the next one, you know, let's see this with a jackknife. And they start just shards of glass. Like, all these instruments, they just start cutting into the necks of these people. And I'm going to show you at the end of the video, you watch the patient and their heads rolling around. But look, so they put the jackknife in, they twist it. I've seen a bunch of Aussies do this, by the way. Not with a jackknife, but with a scalpel. But then they insert a nail clipper. Anything to keep the airway open. It is so good. It is so good. And then they say, you know, a ballpoint pen can be broken and used like this. Anyway, it's just wonderful. And if you need a few yucks, I highly invite you to, yeah. And so watch this. They then secure this, and they say, if you need to do a surgical airway, patients should be referred to see a physician. Like, okay. But watch, they secure this, and then we're going to get a picture of the dude, and he's sitting there going like, oh. Like, there he is, eyes moving. And they try to like keep his head from flopping. It's just classic. It's so good. All right. There's a song here at the end of it, which ends with like the United States military, you know, dun 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 dun. Anyway, but and this guy, it's so good. It's so good. He says, "We now turn you over to your instructor for any additional questions." So, all right. That is me. I just wanted to thank TBS and ATAC. I got up to the top of the Brighthorn, the easiest of the 4,000-meter peaks the other day. Quite the view. It is just wonderful to be here and share airway enthusiasm with all of you from all over the world. And I agree with Michael, the Canadian guidelines are way better than the American. All right, thank you.